I'm attorney Pat Dunn. Auto accidents are a part of life. I hope you never need an attorney, but if you do, the team at the Mack Law Firm is here to help.
I'm going to do this a little bit differently today. I want to tell you about how I came to know Pete Penapinto. It was back in 2002 when I decided to run for mayor again. And there was a young man that also decided to run, and his name was Pete Penapinto. There were five of us in that race, and I'm going to tell you that during that campaign, I became so impressed with Pete. He was young, he was energetic, had a good-looking wife. That was the most important thing. But after I was elected, I remembered all of the good things that he had said during the election, and I took a lot of the things that he had talked about in his campaign in 2002 and incorporated that into my administration. When I had a position that came available as building official, I called on Pete and said, hey, would you be interested in being the building official for the city of Hammond? So he came over to be building official, but then he got a call from one of those insurance companies that said, hey, would you like to come to work for us? And of course, they were paying a lot more money than us. And he said, yes, I'll come if I can come back to this area because I love the city of Hammond. And they promised him that they would give him that. Well, he went through the training, became a licensed insurance agent, but guess what? They didn't move him back in this area. They wanted to send him somewhere else. So Pete said, no, I'm coming back to the city that I love. Well, as time went on, I did have the position that came available again as building official, and I called him and I said, Pete, would you be interested in coming back to the city on a part-time basis? Because by that time, Pete had built up a construction company. He had opened the first of what is now many car washes across South Louisiana. So I convinced him that he should come back to the city of Hammond as building official. Well, unfortunately, we lost the director of administration, Don Holtgren. So I asked Pete again. I said, Pete, will you step up and help the citizens of the city of Hammond and become the head of the Department of Administration? And to me, this was a segue. This was getting on towards the end of my administration. So I thought it was a perfect segue to bring him in and train him and let him see what was happening in the mayor's office, because I knew that one day he would be mayor. And sure enough, here we are a little over 6 years later, having the mayor of the city of Hammond come talk to the Hammond Kiwanis Club. So would you please give a warm Kiwanis welcome to Mayor Pete Penapinto.
It was interesting when I ran against him because I had no clue what I was doing in politics, and nor did I like politicians or what was going on. I wanted to change the world, and I wanted to change, more importantly, not so much change it, but I wanted to keep Hammond the great place that it is. And fortunately for us, Mason was able to win that race, and he started a legacy of his own that truly brought us to where we are today. And I'll tell you a story about myself with Mason when I was with him as director. One of the things that has been big for us is we're always focused on hard work, integrity, transparency, and professionalism. One day I was in Mason's office and Lee Zurich calls, and I don't know if I told y'all this story or not, but Lee said, listen, we want all of your credit cards for your department heads, and we want this and that. And I was sitting across from Mason. He said, well, that's no problem, Lee. He said, I can give it to you three ways. I can give it to you in the form of paper, and you can pay for each page. I can give it to you in the form of a CD. You can pay for the CD. He said, I can mail it to you. And there was a silence. Lee said, no one's ever told me that before, sir. He said, when do you think you can get that to me? Mason said, well, it's Wednesday, Thursday. He said, how about beginning of next week, at the latest next Wednesday? Another silence. And he said, never has anyone told me that. We never heard back from Lee. And from that point, and right after the call, Mason looked at me and says, transparency. That's what you need to be about. Let people know what's going on. When they have questions, answer them. And it will make you the person you truly want to be, especially in politics, since you have doubted so long of what most politicians are about. So thank you for mentoring me, and thank you for making me the politician that I am. So my hat's off to you for that, my friend.
Thank you.
So I'm in the second term of my bid as mayor, and I'm very proud to be your mayor. And I truly love working hard. And the best thing we have going for us is a crew of employees that truly do their jobs and do it well. One of the things when I first came in was made sure that they all knew that I didn't know how to do their jobs. I wasn't going to micromanage, but I would not put up with those who truly didn't want to work, because it's a morale buster for everyone else in each department. So they all know me now as the mayor who expects them to do their job simply. If you need tools for your job, the least I can do for you is get you the tools. That's a very simple thing for me. So I supply them with the tools, I make sure that they have what they need, and with that, we have a great team. A little bit about our budget. It's been crazy times with COVID. I mean, truly, we all know that. I'm sure people are tired of hearing about COVID, but I will tell you, when we were with Mason, we were always struggling. Every year, our fiscal year starts July 1, and we were always concerned. We would start off the fiscal year, and we would do some projects. Christmas and Thanksgiving, the holiday season shopping was what would put us over the edge. So then that next half of the year, we knew what we could truly do with our capital outlay projects that we were trying to do in the city. Usually we were struggling at the end of the year to either make our budget a little bit over, a little bit under, but it was always a struggle. COVID comes, and I'm in a total panic. Don't know what's going to happen. I cut all projects. We're going to sit, and we're going to make sure we operate in the black. We start impressing upon people, please shop at home. Please stay at home, wear your mask, do all the things that everyone's asked to do, wash your hands, stay out of large crowds. And I'll tell you, we have been blessed in this town. We have a $45 million budget. We have $2 million in unallocated funds, and we have a $1.2 million emergency fund. So we are in a very good place financially for the citizens of Hammond. Our sales tax dollars flattened after the 2016 floods, about $20.5 million sales tax dollars coming in. So we would put a 2% add-on to our budget every year, thinking that there would be an increase. Well, after this, I said, listen, we're not adding anything to the budget. We need to make sure we're in the black. So we had some conversation with council members who didn't quite understand why I was doing this. We have a new council, total new council, since the inception of police jury, the very first council it was. But I'll tell you, it's been crazy. Last year, we finished our fiscal year $430,000 over budget for the city of Hammond, which, whether it's because we're the hub of our parish or whatever the reason, people in our community are shopping here. We also added Home Depot. We added some other stores. But I'll tell you, as of right now, January, in this second year of the COVID, we're $1.8 million over budget in the middle of the year, which is just really unheard of. So God has blessed us. I feel for all the businesses out there that are struggling, but however it's happening, we are really in good shape here in Hammond. The majority of our sales tax comes from, our revenue comes from sales tax and property tax. If you all have noticed this year with the property tax, your tax bill came from the parish only. So you had one bill with all your property taxes on it. It was a last minute thing. We had some issues with educating folks on that. So we apologize if some, when you first got your bill and saw that amount, you were like, what the? And then called us and asked us what the heck was going on. We explained to you. So from now on, you'll be getting your bill from the parish. And it's a really good thing for all of us. It's a one-stop shop. So at this point, our budget is truly, we've been blessed here in Hammond. So you can feel good about that. COVID was obviously a challenge. We dealt with our employees. We scrambled. We had some employees who didn't want to drive in vehicles with other ones. So we actually went as far as saying, listen, we'll pay you for your mileage if you want to truly get in another vehicle. We had to shut down our after school care, but yet we used it for our employees' daycare, and we also tutored those children as well. So we changed that up a little bit. We've reached out to businesses and let them know and helped them get aware of the programs for grants. and any of you that may have applied for those programs know that those guidelines changed constantly. And so we tried to keep up with that. They were out of a lot of the bottles and the spray bottles and the hand bottles. So we were getting bottles donated to us from everywhere we could, putting the product in their solution so all of our people, police, fire, and our employees could wash and wipe their hands as often. So it was a challenging time for all of us. 35% of our workforce has been quarantined, waiting on test results, or actually had COVID. And I'll tell you a story about myself, pretty disappointed in myself about it. We did a great job. I have a 91-year-old mother. We have a 77-year-old mother-in-law that lives with me. Very few people over at the house. Thanksgiving, very few people, hardly any, just our group. Christmas, wife wanted to have a few more people. By the end of the day, we had 17 people, family members at our house, 9 of us. And one of the healthiest kids who taught at Cypress Fitness calls the next morning and said, I had fever last night, I'm so sorry, I just tested positive. Mother contracted it, pneumonia in her lungs just a slight bit. My wife had it the worst. This way, everyone's different. You just don't know how it's gonna affect each and every one of us. So you truly need to be careful. You truly need to wear your mask as often as you can. We're all okay, we're blessed. I have a sister in Houston, my oldest sister, who was very upset with me and has not left her house since March. So she's watching things very carefully, and her mother now has COVID because I didn't listen to her and we let these folks over. So you truly need to be careful is the point. COVID, we really just don't know. So I think we're in the right direction, hopefully. Economic development, we have a lot of good businesses coming. Medline, big talk of the town for a while. This company was just a pearl, just like Southeastern, just like our airport. St. Tammany had them for 5 years. They wanted to expand. Mike Cooper ran his president's race on not allowing that to happen. The council voted to approve it. He denied it. They came to me, they came to Robbie Miller went to them, said, hey, Tangipahoa Parish, the best parish in the state. Gets them over here, I'm working with my son on a Saturday demo in the house, and I'm filthy dirty, and they said, listen, can you come over to the office? We have individuals from Medline over here, and they want to meet the mayor of Hammond. I said, I'm filthy dirty, and if you don't mind that, I'm on my way. I said, please come. So I walked in, and I was nasty. And the guy said, thank you so much for coming. Geez, you really were demoing something. Shook their hands, told them we wanted them here after listening to them. This is the largest manufacturing distribution company in the United States. Fortune 500 company, $17 billion in annual sales, zero debt. Everything they do, they cut a check for. Family owned, third generation, there's 3 boys running it right now. So every time there was a challenge with our city and our citizens, I would call. The gentleman's name was Dimitri, who was a land acquisition person. And I said, Dimitri? Well, the second meeting we had was back, and I was cleaned up for that meeting, and we had the number 4 man come down along with Dimitri, and he said, what are the challenges that we may have? And a couple looked across the table at me, shook their head, and I was like, I'm gonna tell you the challenges, because there are gonna be some. I have family and I have friends that live around that airport. You're gonna have a challenge of noise. What are you gonna do about it? Well, we build and we specialize in making sure that we're not a nuisance. We actually take on problems that's there are around some of these facilities we build in neighborhoods. We can put berms. Well, Jeff Smith is on the planning and zoning board. So Jeff, a few meetings later, says, how about you take that 4-foot berm and make it an 8-foot berm? No problem. But how about you take it and set it back off of the road and put a set of a 6-foot fence, put a 10-foot fence and put the blinders in the fence so we can't even see the trucks? No problem. One gentleman said, I jogged that road and it's gonna be full of traffic. No problem, we'll put a 10-foot wide bike path from Vineyard all the way to the end of our property and we'll help the city and parish if they wanna go a little further with it. I said, okay. Then there was a problem with drainage. If anyone builds, whether it's a neighborhood or anything, there's a 100-year floodplain code in place for building, neighborhoods or whatever it's gonna be. They from the get-go said they would do a 200-year floodplain. After people were really upset about drainage, they said, listen, any drainage problem bordering our property, we will put a box drain and we will put a culvert all the way to our pond, retention pond. We'll buy 17 acres adjacent to our property and make the entire place for the retention area. We will make it a 500-year retention pond. They did a soil sample and it had hard soil. So now it's a bigger than well needed, but you never know what around here with our rainfall. So we had a problem with drainage north of the property. It was one of our last things. And we also had a traffic issue. Roundabouts, possibly, J-turns may come in, but we're gonna need to do something. So I said, Demetri, how bad do you really wanna be here? He said, we wanna be here. I said, well, there's a drainage project that we're doing 3 years from now in Oak Creek and Oak Ridge. I said, and this has nothing to do with you. In fact, this would impact you. You wouldn't impact it. He said, well, what are you asking me, Pete? I said, would you consider helping with this project? Let me make a phone call. 5 minutes goes by, calls me right back. He said, the one thing I like about this company, Pete, I used to be with Cardinal for years. He said, is you call, they make a decision. He said, how about if we give you $200,000 towards the project and you handle the rest? I said, yes, sir, thank you. We'd love to do a cooperative endeavor agreement. So they helped us solve that problem. Anything that came up, this company was willing to participate. Calls me 2 days ago. Options, nonprofit behind us. Is that a viable company? Is it good, run really well? I said, yes, sir, sure is. He said, well, they gave me a call. I see an email. What's her name that runs
out?
Miss Sylvia Bush, thanking him for a $20,000 check. They haven't even broke ground yet. So this is a community partner with wherever they go, and they're already showing it. I know there are a lot of questions. I have friends and family, and I truly believe they're gonna be an asset. As I said, a Fortune 500 company. They have 45 distribution centers in the United States, 200 worldwide, 30 manufacturing offices, labs, and distribution centers. This is a $75 million project. And as I was talking to him yesterday, I said, because I was going over some notes for him for this speech, and I said, when we got to that point, and he said, well, it's a $75 million project. And I said, could be a $77 million project, right? And he kind of laughed because we had mentioned to him before about this roundabout. And I said, you know, there are citizens that feel like the $500,000 you receive from the state is taxpayer money, not your money. Would you be willing to help us with the roundabout? So he made a phone call, called me back, and he said, listen, let us get the property purchase and get this thing started, and we'll talk about that. So I fully am hoping, I won't say I expect, but I'm hoping that they will help us with that particular roundabout, because we're doing a traffic study now, and DOTD wanted to encompass that roundabout. They wanted to encompass RJ turns, encompass the airport road intersection with the light, and then also down airport road toward the interstate. So the pay with these jobs, they're going to start off immediately with 75 jobs. By 3 years, they should have 150. And between 5 and 10 years, everything goes well. They're going to be at a capacity of 450 jobs there. They alternate when people come and go from work to help with traffic. Don't go through the peak times. It's going to take about 18 months to build. They fully expect the building to be up by October, November. And then it takes a while to get it stocked with inventory and start shipping, approximately April of 2022. Annual payroll, once everything is up and going, is gonna be approximately $24 million. So this is a Fortune 500 company in our city that's a community partner, and I truly believe it's gonna be very good for our community. Would have been great in the parish, would have been great wherever, but this land acquisition individual saw this spot, really wanted it, and they went after it. And through a lot of meetings, and I look at a friend right now who's looking at me, and I don't know what he's thinking, but I think and I truly believe this is gonna work out for all of us. You're around an airport, for one, which has been there since before World War II. You have the Blackhawks there. You have a nitrogen company that's right there that trucks nitrogen in and out of there. You have Conrad Anderson that's been there before. All of these things other than Nitrogen Company had been there before, all of the neighborhoods. I'm not saying I don't disagree with your thoughts. I'm saying it was a site-ready site. It's in an industrial setting as well as it is in a housing setting. They're doing as much as they can do with buffering with trees, berms, a wall on that building that 2 feet away, it's concrete, you can't hear what's going on inside. The trucks are gonna be, it could be an issue. As I told him, I drove trucks. I said, look, let me tell you something. What's the first thing a truck does when it stops? I said, what are you talking about? He said, you pull a brake. That is probably the only thing you'll hear. At night times, they're gonna be mostly on the inside. The trailer's gonna be there. We're gonna have to see. I believe it's a good business for that location. You live right there. I lived in Oak Knoll for a year. And you could hear the facility that Ed Hoover has right down the street for Walmart as well. And that was the only thing I heard at night was that brake air release. Yes, sir. If it's a roundabout, DOTD has been really big about not always doing roundabouts, which I would hope that we do, and doing what they call J-turns. You turn right, and you go up a little bit and you take a U-turn and come back. That's a really big thing that they do. St. Tammany, who has a lot of income coming in, revenue, has done multiple roundabouts throughout their community, and it's working. Roundabouts really work well. As I've said, I drove 18 wheelers as a young man. I tell people all the time, you either need to be in front of that truck or behind it. Don't be on side because there's a blind spot. And if you're going on a roundabout and you're on that inside, that's a horrible place to be. You don't want to be there. So you let that truck either get ahead of you or go behind it or be in front of it. If it's a roundabout, DOTD has been really big about not always doing roundabouts, which I would hope that we do, and doing what they call J-turns. You turn right and you go up a little bit and you take a U-turn and come back. That's a really big thing that they do. St. Tammany, who has a lot of income coming in, revenue, has done multiple roundabouts throughout their community, and it's working. Roundabouts really work well. As I've said, I drove 18 wheelers as a young man. I tell people all the time, you either need to be in front of that truck or behind it. Don't be on side because there's a blind spot, and if you're going on a roundabout, and you're on that inside, that's a horrible place to be. You don't want to be there. So you let that truck either get ahead of you or go behind it or be in front of it. Educational support. Our after school program was discontinued because of COVID, obviously. We immediately started the daycare, as I said. Judge Gashaway and I still did the backpack. We gave away about 1,200 backpacks, but what we did this time was we set up tents and people drove through and we handed through the windows to the children and the families. Our summer camp had to be canceled. We weren't able to do anything with that. Zumeri Pool was finished, but it wasn't able to open. We're hoping to open it for Memorial Day. Offering free swim. Swim leagues have already started using it. Our high schools have started using it. The fire department has used it for training for water rescue. So it's already being used. As you'll see right now, if you pass over there, we're putting a parking lot in. So that should be completed by then. We're also finishing up $1 million of drainage projects, which was part of $675,000 of a sewer project rehabilitation, which was part of a community block development block grant. That was over at Palmetto to Thomas, Morrison to Mooney area. We're just about finishing that up right now. The $1 million drainage project is Iowa District, Lincoln Park, West Charles, Blackburn, Whitmore. Whitmore, we should be completing a project that we've started probably about three years ago, if not a little longer than that. We just about have Whitmore with as much as we can do to help that community when it rains really heavy. We're finally breaking ground on our new sewer treatment plant, our pond, which is now a $2.5 million pond. That's gonna help with that sediment to give it more time to settle and have that water clean for our citizens. So that's huge for the future of the city of Hammond and our infrastructure. Yes, sir? The airport. So was the whole thing blank? And I was worried. I'm sorry, I apologize. The airport, now the fastest growing and rated number one airport for small airports in the state of Louisiana. 87,000 movements. We were shut down for 2 weeks for COVID. The airport tower, a tower that because of Mason and his efforts and the congressmen and senators and everyone involved in politics from Washington down here, Mason was able to get 850,000, I think it was, or 800,000 from the federal government, 700,000 or so from the state, and they built that tower. That tower was built 100% funds outside of the city. The Army National Guard, Mason had made a deal with them, and you can correct me at any time, boss, about when they finished their location, they were temporarily housed over there for Katrina, and when they finished that location that they built out there for the Army National Guard, which houses the Blackhawks, and also the construction team in the back, that they would build a string of 10 hangars, which they did. We had no cost other than to maintain the building. Army National Guard brought in their own air traffic controllers. It is an educational center for air traffic controllers for the Army National Guard, the second largest in the country. Another great asset that we have there, our responsibility is the building, the facility. They, Army National Guard, also handles the equipment. We just did get the dollars and we finished up the elevator, which we didn't have an elevator for a while. It was quite a hike if you took a tour of that location. And now we have all the floors finished. So we're finally finished with that. And that was a big, big thing for the city of Hammond and that airport, because a lot of these corporate jets will not land without a tower. So now we have a lot more traffic coming in, a lot bigger birds coming in, taking out more fuel, making more money for the city of Hammond's airport, which is now operating in the black, first time for a long time, and we're very proud of that. $1.3 million is what it cost to buy that property at the southeast end of the airport. When I first came into office, one of the things that FAA and DOTD Louisiana, which took over this facility, said that we really needed to do was we needed to cut the trees down where Mr. Bob Moran owned, which back in the day, he had sued, the city tried to expropriate it, he had sued, he won, so he didn't really have a big love for the airport. So one day he called me and asked me, look, I'm moving, my brother Jimmy moved, my sister's gone, I'm thinking about moving, are you interested in buying the property? Yes, I talked to the state, federal government gave us $1 million. We had to come up with $300,000. Council wasn't really intrigued in doing that. And they were a new council and thought the dollars should possibly be spent somewhere else, and that's fine. Trying to give them as much credit as I can. We have to deal with each other, and I know in the heart of hearts they want to do what's right, and I would hope that would be the case. So it's coming to the time where the FAA and DOTD is saying, listen, we put 100% $2 million into your intersection and rebuilt it. We built your tower. You've got to show where your community wants this airport, or you're gonna have trouble with getting funding. Here's $1 million we're giving you. If it's less than $1 million, fine. If it's over $1 million, you have to come up with the funds. So it ended up coming back after the appraisal at 1.3. I'm 3 months away from the end of the year and we lose $1 million. No one is considering it. No one wants to hear about it. So, someone who doesn't have a lot of money, I take $10,000 of my personal money and I start going to people at that airport. And I say, listen, I know this is not something that we should be doing, because I had a number of them say, the government should be, the city should be paying for this. I said, I'm not arguing that, but I have 3 months. In 2 months, we raised $230,000. And I went back to the council and said, listen, this can happen, but it would be nice if you could help out with this and finish this thing out. So they did. We had a lot of folks talk to them, and we were able to purchase this property. It was it was incredible to see the folks. And I don't know, has anyone from Stoa Corporation in here? We had the likes of Tommy Ironman with Top Gun, Aaron Pierce with his company, people just stepping up. Mr. Gray, Mike Gray of Gray Insurance, helping us out. We were able to purchase that. We're now in the environmental stage. That's just about finished, and we should be able to cut some trees. We just need to put a buffer around there. Some folks worrying about noise because it was never opened up before. But this would allow a displacement of 700 foot off of that southeast runway coming into that airport. So in other words, when you're taking off from the northwest, you need to get over that tree line. Once those are gone, you won't have that problem. When you're coming in from the southeast, you have 700 foot less of runway than you would coming from the other side. So it's a safety issue. We just moved, annexed it into the city of Hammond. So that's another huge asset for our airport, and it's really good for aviation. Safety programs. Police and fire are emphasizing training and modernizing equipment. Mason taught me that a long time ago. We do spend dollars on training, and we want our people to be well trained. On the police side, we were on the forefront and already had begun a right training, racial intelligence training. It's an 8-hour class led by Jada Giovingo. She's a reserve officer whose husband was a police officer in St. John Parish. And she said, listen, there's a training going on in Florida. I'll pay for my trip, I'll pay for my room, I'll pay for my view. Will you pay for the class? It's like, yes. She goes down, she gets trained. She is now our facilitator of these classes that we do. And it also helps with, focuses on diversity, inclusion, de-escalation, communication, police misconduct, understanding harassment, professional civil training program, established to provide members of the community with background and understanding of our procedures. Also, and that's part of our Citizens Academy as well. We started Citizens Academy last week. 34 people came to the academy, citizens, just because they want to know the things that I just said. They want to know why, the why behind the incidents, why police officers do what they do, how they were trained, and what the concept is, and what the thought pattern is of a police officer. Nowadays, things have changed, so the training is changing. You know the big episode we had with my police chief, and it was perceived to be something that it truly wasn't. I had the NAACP from Tangipahoa in, and then I had a state rep in. We looked at it in my office. It just doesn't look good that the man is not being hit in the head. He was trained to hit in the top torso. And, you know, if that's the case and it shouldn't be done that way, then we need to change training. So that's an issue that we're working, and the chief is working extremely hard to make sure that we correct and we move in the right direction. On the fire side, we've hosted a rookie school. We'll be hosting our third very soon. We're becoming one of the premier training facilities for fire departments. We had a gentleman from Kenner, New Orleans, St. John Parish, and then four of our own that just graduated with the fire department. We have a new facility out there that was given to us by the federal government, the Army Guard facility over there, which is really, really great for us. I would love to be able to move that fire station there one day, simply because it's safer to get in and out. And also, possibly one day, put a firearm shooting facility for police station. But that was one of those things where a few people tried to get it as well. Miss Sylvia tried to get it. Daniel was with the TPSO, was looking at it, and I begged him. I said, listen, I've been working on this for a few years. Please, please. So for $1, we ended up receiving that facility, which is really good for us here. Thankful to those folks for allowing us. Because if you do go head to head with another organization, whether it's public or private, it's a bid process, and we would have had to pay. So a great facility for us there. We just purchased a 75-foot ladder truck, which we have one now, but it's not 75 foot. It has an apparatus sprayer on the very end to where it can spray down the top of buildings. Which is a lot safer for our firemen because we were hanging off the top of the other ladder truck on top. I can remember when Lee's and Super King was burning, the guy was on the top of that ladder hanging with the hose. Not very safe. Also allows you to have a ladder on top of buildings for them something to stand on. If the building's
you know, undefined, could possibly collapse. So that's a great asset that we have and we were able to purchase this year. 5 minutes? Okay. So look, with that being said, what's new this year coming is a better website, a new website that'll help with people when they come online looking for jobs or for payments or what's going on in the city of Hammond. We have taken down over 100, I think there might have been 100 houses taken down before Mason left office. So we take down houses, we have a process that we go through if they're blighted or if there are problems, we send the certified letters. You have to do a legal process and then we take them down. We've taken down generally 10 a year. The process that we haven't perfected is how to get it back in commerce with a clean title. There's a company out there that sells the house with a bond to it. So if heirs came back and said, that's my property, I want, well then the bond is supposed to hopefully pay them off or whatever, but it's still not the clear title. We've been watching New Orleans do this for a while, and that's the scare of that trash. I had a young man that needed to do service hours, and I picked up with him Saturday and Sunday, and we picked up 16 bags. And you know as well as I know, it's an education thing. And there are people out there that don't really think about it. And, you know, police, if we could catch them doing it and give them that ticket, I'm sure you would think twice before you did it again if you paid $150, $200. So that's a constant problem, and that's why we pick up all the time. Yes, sir. Recycling is near and dear to a lot of folks' heart. The problem with recycling is it is not a money maker for people doing it, and what happens is they charge you for it. I'm looking at my neighbor right now who they missed his can for 4 weeks straight. I live and he paid $100. Well, any curbside pickup was between you and the vendor. Well, we would get into calls. We called the vendor and said, look, we're not your answer service. You need to handle this service. The bottom line with recycling is China and other companies, countries that were doing it, stopped. They stopped buying it from us. What hurts recycling is those folks that truly are into it, they get their kids into it, and they truly separate. Plastics, believe it or not, cardboard, if it has the grease from the pizza, the whole shipment's no good. So they've gotten to the point to where if there's something in there, food, they're not taking the recycling. It's got to be clean cardboard. We have a company, Pratt Industries, who just came in, and they are a full service recycling of cardboard. That's all they do. The problem is people don't think about, not everyone thinks, they think the recycling can, they just throw their regular trash in. You end up paying for the recycling and it goes to the dump the majority of the time anyway. There is a company that guarantees, for the most part, we talked about it with Bob Zavia, because Bob and City of Ponchatoula and Hammond are connected to the contract so we can get a better price. Now we changed our dates to connect with the parish, so now we can get a better price having the whole parish together with whoever we use. But recycling isn't working. And the educational fact to it is, this company out of Alabama where we were offered to bring the recycling to, they would just put it in all the garbage. And the facility they have will separate it, and 30% of it would probably get to recycling, but the cost of getting it there. So it's not a profitable item for these companies. As I told him, please, if they're making any type of money, ask them to build one here. So I'm not sure that they're making enough money to build them around the country yet, but recycling at this point in time truly isn't working, and it's something that we, you know, we have the recycling, we still do it out at 190. I know a lot of folks don't want to travel out there. And we have our people out there twice a month, and we'll help folks. But we have some folks that really like it that can't handle the weight of it. So it's a challenge entirely, to be honest with you.
Thank you very much. It takes more than one person to assist in a personal injury claim. I am attorney Glenn Westmoreland, and we have a strong team at the Mack Law Firm. It is our goal to make sure your injury is properly attended to. Contact me at tangylawteam.com and let us get you the help you need.